amazing finish.
They need to go for the shot. Brace will take it from way out. Mike Ellis, the captain, and he's missed.
That's got to have a three-pointer to go to extra time. Mike Ellis throws it up. He makes it! Unbelievable, Mike Ellis!
For basketball fans in 1990, the Perth Entertainment Centre was the place to be. Over the next hour, we'll take you through the highs and the lows of the Wildcats season. A season that could become the year of the Cat.
Should be a regulation 2 points. Close goes under the basket. Hinder even the heart. It's Davis on his feet. No offense, nobody at home on the board. A chance to come down on the break.
One or two Ellis back. It comes to Allen inside to Grace. Oh, nice move, Ricky Grace. Spin turn on the glass.
The Wildcats are a sporting phenomenon in Perth. Their following has grown incredibly since 1987. It was then that the team was transferred to private ownership, moved to the Superdrome, and recruited dynamic new players. But it hasn't always been that way. In fact, the Wildcats weren't even around when the National Basketball League kicked off in 1979. The team first entered the NBL in 1982, finishing 10th in the 14-team competition and playing its games before small but enthusiastic crowds at the Perry Lake Stadium. Among the coaches in those early years, the noisy and sometimes dramatic Jay Bramer. But it wasn't until Bob Williams took over at the end of 1986 that the Wildcats became a serious player on the national scene.
I was invited to initially become a sponsor, and although I was reluctant to get involved in the first instance, when I went to the games as a guest, I think I just immediately was captivated, as so many people are when they first see a game of basketball, and the opportunity was there, and I could see the potential of it.
In fact, the Wildcats became an instant success. Cal Bruton was a walking, talking public relations machine, and the fans loved it.
Cal was head and shoulders above anybody else that I could find as a potential employee or part of the organisation. He had the skills to be able to play, he had the skills to coach, and as has been proven, he had the skills to promote the sport.
In the very first year of the new regime, the revitalised Perth Wildcats made it all the way to the grand final, but then lost the title fight to the fired-up Brisbane Bullets. Wanting to go one better the next year, the Wildcats brought in big man Paul Kuiper. His added height strengthened the Cats, but in a disappointing end of the season, they were bundled out of the 1988 semi-finals by the North Melbourne Giants.
They don't know how to slow down North Melbourne.
Like I said, we just sort of lost a little bit of composure when it counted most, but I guess overall we have to be pleased, but we would love to be playing off in the grand final.
1989 brought tragedy to the Wildcats with the untimely death of Scott Fenton, killed along with fiancée Tina Christie of the Waste Breakers when their car was destroyed in a horror smash on a suburban highway. Scott was one of the Cats' most popular young players. The fan mail he received was testimony to that. And he was greatly admired by his teammates.
I lost my best friend, Scott Fenton. You know, that's kind of hard and still bothers me a little bit, you know, but my life goes on, but his memory will always be with me.
On the court, 1989 promised much. The Wildcats won 16 of their 24 regular season games, finishing in third place. But again, they were bundled out of the semi-finals by the Giants. The last game of the series, a 55-point thrashing.
Gives it back to Fisher. Great play by...
And so 1990 has brought further changes. The entry of a new part owner in Kerry Stokes, adding his talents to the management and entrepreneurial skills of Bob Williams.
Kerry is a successful business person. He has a lot to contribute. He's a person that has a broad understanding of sport. He's played sport at a high level himself. And so in every respect, he makes a contribution. I think what Kerry has done coming on board the organisation is strengthened overall, all aspects. We get on extremely well together, discuss things in an open forum basis, and it's a great sense of cooperation. So when you get people that are contributing like that, you must benefit.
Wildcats epitomise to me the good things that were happening in Perth at the time, and I wanted to have an involvement with them.
1990 also brought a move to the entertainment centre, increasing home crowds to more than 8,000 at each game, a far cry from those early days in the Perry Lake Stadium. That comparison is best summed up by the player who's been with the Wildcats since their inception, team captain Mike Ellis.
I had some good vibes about it. I enjoyed playing in the old days at Perry Lakes, and you know, there's about three men and their dog in the stands, and it was really good. And then, you know, you'd get introduced onto the court, and you know, one or two people might clap, and they might, you know, half the team wouldn't realise that you're out there. They're out getting hot dogs and all that. Now, I mean, you get introduced, there's spotlights, there's dancing girls, there's, you know, the choir singing the national anthem, the whole bit. And it's really gone Hollywood. But that's good too. And it's now, before you used to go and watch a basketball game, now I think you go and you have a night's entertainment. It's not just a game.
That change has actually alienated some of the basketball purists, hasn't it?
It has, definitely. In the old days, everybody in the stand knew basketball, and they knew it to a T. Now you get a stage where you haven't got that many basketball purists, as you said, and there's people that just go to enjoy the entertainment and the spectacle of the game.
It's also changed the way the crowd barracks, hasn't it? Because if we remember those old days when we used to introduce you, the purists who went along clapped every good play, whether it was yours or the opposition's.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it was. There was a time when, you know, you'd be playing away and someone would do a good thing, and you think, hang on, what are they clapping for them for, you know? But now it's getting a lot more parochial, and I think it's good. And if you go to the other states, I think we're a lot fairer over here. You know, we still do clap the opposition occasionally, not all that often, but occasionally. But over the east, they're just virtually downright rude most of the time.
The start of the 1990 season saw the Wildcats' first two-game road trip. After being touted as championship favourites in the pre-season build-up, they made heavy going of it against the Geelong Supercats. It wasn't until David Close, in his first NBL game, hit 3 three-pointers halfway through the third quarter that the Wildcats took the lead.
As you feel, this is a game of momentum. You can feel that some of that momentum that Supercats had going for them about 2 minutes ago is slowly disappearing. David Close knocks down his third three-pointer.
It was a strange feeling after that first game because Geelong weren't exactly a powerhouse team the year previously, and everyone expected so much of us in our first game and for the season in general. I think there was a little bit of a downer that we only won by as much as we did, but personally I can't say I was too disappointed because I did quite well.
And that's it, as Alan Black goes over to shake Barry Barnes's hand, and the Perth Wildcats escape with the points from the arena in Geelong.
The next night the Wildcats travelled to the Glasshouse in Melbourne to confront the Westside Melbourne Saints. Again they struggled, finally going down by 19 points. Despite being 4 from 4 from the field with 7 rebounds, Jeff Allen only got 18 minutes court time from coach Alan Black. A fact he says was due to the way the game was played.
Allen made some changes. We had to press, and he put the quicker guys in, and we ended up pressing and chasing them all over for most of the game. And I'm not really a pressing type of player. I'm more of the half court, you know, and a defensive player. So he chose to take me out and go for the quicker players. And I don't really remember what happened, but I think we lost by about 25 that night. So it was a tough night both ways. I didn't play that much, and we lost, so it was hard.
19 points is the margin at the end, and Dean Templeton wins in his first attempt at an NBL senior coach.
In hindsight, perhaps, that was a mistake by Alan Black. In what was the most controversial move of the NBL season, he was sacked and replaced by general manager Cal Bruton. The Black Pearl admits he was a little nervous before his first game back at the helm against the Illawarra Hawks.
That tells the story. How about your applause there?
It was a long time since I had been in a situation where I had fans sort of boo me on the court, mostly from an opposition point of view. I got used to that in Adelaide, but never in a hometown situation.
But putting a tumultuous week behind them, the team combined a 60% shooting statistic with a huge 50-31 rebounding advantage and some great three-pointers, taking out the game 125-118.
New court, new environment.
James Crawford, and a little jump for Glean, JC.
The next week saw the Wildcats journey to Queensland to take on the NBL's latest addition, the Gold Coast Cougars. Among them, former Wildcat Paul Kuiper.
So it felt like I was training against the guys once again and going against James and Tani. I really wasn't nervous as I would be probably playing against other NBL teams because I'm more familiar with these guys.
Mike Ellis is doing a lot of the damage. Back to Grace. Lovely shot for 3 points. That looks so easy.
9 of the 10 Perth players shot above 50% from the floor. And despite the Cougars' 15 three-pointers, they never overcame the Wildcats' quarter-time 11-point break. Perth went on to win the game 121-112.
So congratulations to the Wildcats. They won their third game of the season.
The Wildcats stayed home for their fifth game of the season against the Newcastle Falcons. By the end of the first quarter, they trailed by 5 points. But thanks to some solid shooting by Mike Ellis, the Wildcats recovered to record a 6-point halftime advantage, 43-37. Although neither team shot well, the Wildcats had 21 more rebounds than the Falcons and took the game 116-94. And so after 5 games, the Wildcats stood in 5th place on the NBL ladder, with the prospect of facing Canberra at home next game up. After the break, we'll look at that game. James Crawford will give us some hints on sleeping comfortably.
My favourite player is James Crawford, and I was just wondering whether his feet hang out the end of the bed when he goes to sleep.
I sleep in the bed almost in an angle, and I guess some of my worst nightmares when I go on the road trip and they sleep in the motel room, and your feet get hung at the foot of the bed and you try to turn over and it's tucked underneath of it really tight, so you almost get trapped in there. So.
And James isn't the only one to get trapped. On April 27th, against the Canberra Cannons, the Wildcats were up by 14 points at quarter time. Despite Phil Smythe's injured wrist, the Cannons recovered in the second quarter to go into halftime only 4 points down.
Just two, make that four. Quarter baseline. Over the top of Atkinson. Crawford on the top, back to Ellis. Nice.
By the end of the game, the scores were tied at 103 apiece. In overtime, the Wildcats had trouble finding an answer to the Cannons' Tad Duffelmeyer.
Steal it was from Grace, and Duffelmeyer was right.
Yeah, sometimes when a guy's hot, he's hot. And no matter what you do, he's going to bust through your defense. But I suppose in trying different personnel on a bigger guy or double-teaming him whenever he got the ball would have forced him to do something different.
And the final score saw the Cannons win the game by 5 points, 116-111.
So at the end of overtime, a very, very, very good result for the Canberra Cannons. They have won this by 5 points.
The Mother's Day weekend. And after a bye the previous week, Western Australia's NBL team was on the road again. It was a lacklustre performance, though, by the Wildcats. 10th placed Hobart were able to stay in touch well into the last quarter when Eric Watterson took on the role of point guard, a job he enjoys.
I have to marshal the troops, that sort of thing, and I'm better at that rather than being the shooter on the team. There's a lot of other guys that are better shooters than I am, so I'll leave that up to them.
The team from Perth improved in the last term, but didn't put the game away until the closing minutes.
That foiled the trap. Watterson, beautiful move to Torrance. And Trevor says thank you very much and gives the old slam dunk. 2 seconds remaining, last shot of the game. Air ball. And the Devils, a plucky performance, but not good enough in the end. The class of the Perth Wildcats in the end told, and they run out winners by 11 points. 102 plays 91.
The next day they travelled to Melbourne to meet the Tigers in what promised to be the game of the round. But a 20-point haul in the first quarter by Melbourne's Andrew Gaze ensured a meek Mother's Day surrender by the Wildcats, who never recovered from a 13-point quarter-time deficit. To compound their problems, James Crawford left the game just before half-time with an ankle injury.
Crawford.
It was very frustrating because for us the fans see you on the court, they expect to see you perform at 100%, and when you can't do that, it's very disappointing.
The final score saw Melbourne win by 26 points and the Wildcats dropped a 6th spot on the NBL ladder.
At the Glasshouse, a big win set up in the first half. The
Tigers 133 to the Wildcats 107.
Game nine for the Wildcats, and fresh from their first win of the season the previous night against Adelaide, the Geelong Supercats initially continued their strong form against the Perth side. However, a persistent defence, together with a multi-pronged attack, saw the Wildcats shooting 60% from the field to run away with the game in the last quarter, 119-102.
Well done, Bateman. Pinned against the basket on the buzzer, and it's 119-102.
The next week, the NBL's 1989 champions, North Melbourne, arrived in Perth after losing their first game of the season to Adelaide. In an unusual move, Cal Bruton left James Crawford and Tiny Pinder on the bench and used instead Steve Davis and Trevor Torrance in the starting five.
Because, you know, once you get used to a starting five and then have to change it over, it could have... I don't think it should really affect you in any way. You should be prepared to go with any combination, just go from there. But there are times when you have that mental lapse and you're not quite ready, and all of a sudden, bam, it's happening. It's like, oh, wow, what do I do?
Hit a double team, still gets the ball to Fisher.
Sensational. Really claimed that ball. Palmer's not happy, claiming a goal 10. And a finger roll on the baseline. The Wildcats are certainly back in it. Crawford again. Oh, the full court press. Now the work for the Wildcats. Great pressure.
After being 7 points down at quarter time, the Wildcats continued the struggle and went into the last term with an 11-point deficit. At the final buzzer, it was North Melbourne 108 to the Wildcats 94. Freshened up after their second bye for the year, the Wildcats travelled to Boondall for the first game of a daunting road trip. With three fouls in the first quarter, Ricky Grace had trouble adjusting to the different Australian style of refereeing.
They tend to call a few more just little touch fouls, and in the States they really let the guards get up and play physical and strong, and they don't do that here, and I kind of adjusted to that now, so...
25-point first half by Leroy Loggins contributed to the Bullets' 14-point halftime lead. James Crawford's 9 slam dunks provided one of the few high points of the game. The final score, the Bullets 112, the Wildcats 101. Game 2 of the road trip saw the Perth side travel to Melbourne the next day to meet the East side Melbourne Spectres. The lead changed 24 times in the game. Ricky Grace was the Wildcats' shining light with 25 points, going 6 from 6 at the free throw line. Eric Watterson sums up his teammates' attributes.
Ricky has just got so many tools to go with. He can shoot from the outside and drive it to the basket, rebound. You know, he's just a great player.
Although the game wasn't decided until the last minute, the Perth team generally dictated the terms and ran out winners 114-104. Despite their good form against East Side, the Wildcats dropped out of the top six and faced the prospect of the eighth-placed Sydney Kings the next week. We'll feature that game and a behind-the-scenes look at basketball after the break.
Normally before every game, I go home and have something to eat, and I sit down and put a movie in the video. And you might believe this, but I'm a martial art. I enjoy watching the old Chinese martial art. I watch those films, and that particular film that motivates me before the game. I do that every game.
Leaving Sammy on reception, I mean, we'd sort of discussed that.
These are the scenes behind the on-court glamour. This team is responsible for the day-to-day decisions that help prepare the side for each match. Simply, the Wildcats couldn't exist without them.
I'm just informing Channel 7 of all the advertising that we will need to make sure that the general public are aware of what games we will play at the finals at home and when they can get the tickets. If we get it wrong here, it will just cause chaos.
In the build-up to a game, hundreds of tickets must be counted, sorted, and then sent out.
These tickets are going to go to Bob Williams. Can you get them coded out for me?
Sure.
And Sammy, I need to know now if it's costing me ready for training tonight.
Okay.
Thanks.
Travel arrangements for away matches must be finalised, with players and the media informed of any changes. The Wildcats handle almost constant inquiries from the media.
Hi, can I help you?
Yes, I'm Grant Retallick from Channel 7. I have an appointment with Cal Bruton.
Cal Bruton is also the club's general manager, but as a game approaches, his coaching duties are the number one priority. His video library includes every Wildcats match and is used to study the opposition.
My day normally starts at 6:30 in the morning and might finish anywhere from 12:30 to 2 in the morning, yeah. But it's something you enjoy, so you don't call it work.
Several of the players help out in the office during a normal week. They assist in the development of junior basketball and, time permitting, respond to mail sent in by hundreds of fans. Each of them must learn to mix work with play.
I don't actually forget about the game while I'm at work. I still have got the game in the back of my mind and I'm thinking about what I'm supposed to be doing. But I also have my job to do, so you know, they're two different worlds, basically.
It's late afternoon, and while an important sponsorship deal is being worked out, the doors close on a typical day at the Wildcats office. That, of course, is only a very brief glimpse into the behind-the-scenes activities of the Wildcats. It's a fact, though, that a great deal of work goes into each home and away game, and not just within the Wildcats organisation. Our own crews at Channel 7 put in thousands of man-hours each season to put you in the best seat in the house. Six hours before a match is scheduled to begin, camera operators, sound technicians and engineers are setting up the equipment that will take the game onto your television screens at home. In television terms, it's called an outside broadcast, or OB. Commentators are also given the final touch. Makeup helps to reduce the shine from television lighting.
Just in the case of the viewers that I don't get made up, John Gardner does, and it's quite a deal.
You're not bad, are you?
Hey, you're still going in the foreground. Here I am, just walked in.
Ready. Natural. Natural.
Here we go.
Easy.
And from a studio at Channel 7 in Tewart Hill, opening credits are cued to be played. From the control room, graphics of lists and names are added to enhance the broadcast.
So away we go. The Wildcats.
The game coverage is coordinated by a director who follows the play using six cameras which provide a variety of shots.
The director's role is to direct cameras on an outside broadcast. So for the Wildcats game tonight, we have six cameras on the game. And the idea is to have a basic plan, just a pattern of play with, say, three cameras, and then just sprinkle it with another three cameras, just to add a little bit into it.
Get the replay on that. Bring it in.
There are two roving on-court cameras for the close-up action. Playing an important support role in that regard are the cable pullers.
Oh, it's just making sure that the cable doesn't get tied up anywhere, doesn't restrict the cameraman in any way, and making sure it's generally nice and safe for all the people on the court.
Replay take two. Here's a replay on that.
Slow motion replays are a vital part of the coverage. Two operators act independently of the director to capture the action from the best angle. A live telecast will last 2 hours or more. And during that time, total concentration is required to ensure the coverage runs as smoothly as possible.
Goodwin. Oh, Ricky Gray, sensational. Watch this. Yep, that's his second. Two great left-handed jams by Grace, and he's up and pumped. And that was a great athletic effort to get that steal and then the dunk on the end of it.
Game 13 of the season was indeed unlucky for the Perth Wildcats. In front of a parochial crowd of more than 10,000, the Sydney Kings established an early lead and maintained it. Although Perth had a good second quarter, the Kings lifted after Steve Carfino slipped on the floor in the first half and was forced to leave the game. At one stage in the fourth quarter, Sydney led by more than 25 points. Coach Cal Bruton had to do something. He did just that. He had himself thrown out of the game.
He's out. It's triple trouble. It's three technical fouls and Cal Bruton is out of the game. Is that four?
I think it was three, but certainly out of the game, Cal.
Well, Cal has done such a fine job of keeping a lid on it for the entire game, took a step on the court, and then went on with it. And you never win against referees.
And we were down, so 25 points. So I was a little upset with a couple of officials' calls. And I asked him why he'd make this call. Well, he blew a tech on me straight away. So I walked into the court and asked him, you know, why did he blow the tech? And he says, get off the court. And I said, well, explain to me why. So he blew another tech. So I said, well, now that we done blown two and we got everyone's attention, why don't you blow a third? And he obliged me. So I had to leave, but the pressure was off the team at that stage. I just, at that point, didn't lose my cool or anything, but I was just making a point.
And despite, or perhaps due to Cal's early departure, the Wildcats got back to within 12 points before eventually going down to the Kings 114-98.
Well, they lost Steve Carfino, but the Kings went on with it anyway.
Back at the Entertainment Centre for the first of six consecutive home games, the Wildcats played host to the Adelaide 36ers. Big man Jeff Allen missed the first of six straight games due to an Achilles problem.
It was agonising. You know, with the first game, I thought it wasn't going to be that hard and I'd be out there another week or two. But as it got longer and longer, I really started to just wonder what's going on and when I'll be back out there. And it really got hard, you know, seeing the guys playing and not even be able to participate a little bit in practice. And the times when I did, you know, the Achilles swelled up a little bit, and it was hard for me to understand personally what's going on here and when I'm going to be back out there. So
the Wildcats were up by eight at halftime, but couldn't maintain the lead in the third quarter. Adelaide recovered to be just 1 point behind going into the final term. They had an 8-point lead with 5 minutes to play, but the 36ers stopped dead.
Well, the Wildcats need to get inside.
James Crawford's quarter, without a doubt. We've talked about it earlier. He's put it to him. He's isolated. He's come all the way through and jammed it once more. The 36ers have no answer for him defensively at the moment.
At the end of the game, the Wildcats had won 114-105.
So a 9-point split to the Perth Wildcats. And what a great finish that was from them. They scored 29 points in that final quarter.
To 21 from the 36ers.
21, and most of those in the first 7 minutes.
Despite their win against Adelaide, the Wildcats dropped to eighth spot on the NBL ladder, being 8-6 along with four other teams. One of those, the Sydney Kings, came to town the next week for a rematch of the game played only 2 weeks earlier in Sydney. Steve Carfino was back, but the Kings were unable to establish an inside game. Perth improved their margin at every break, and at one stage led by 20 points in the third term. In a reversal of the result 2 weeks earlier, Perth took the game 115-99 and moved to fifth spot.
He can't control it. There's the buzzer. It's all over at the Perth Entertainment Centre. 115-99. The Wildcats win it big.
The rising popularity of basketball was evident in the NBL's 15th week of the season, when a record crowd of 12,500 witnessed the Canberra Bullets clash at Boondall in Brisbane. But back at home at the Entertainment Centre, it was the Wildcats versus the Hobart Tassie Devils. The home side made heavy going of the first half to be only 1 point in front going into the third quarter. But during that term, they outscored Hobart 36-19 and went on to win the game by 30 points.
Excellent result for the Perth Wildcats. That really is a stunning finish. The Cats have come from a 2-point deficit at quarter time to record a 30-point victory.
After the break, we'll look at the two men who hold the purse strings of the Perth Wildcats.
The player I probably most admire would be Ricky Grace. I just wanted to ask you if you're going to continue playing for the Wildcats.
Yeah, I'll be here next year. I'm looking forward to next year. Hopefully, I'll be coming back next year as a champion and being ready to be repeat champions.
Midway through their run of six consecutive home games, the Wildcats came up against the Westside Melbourne Saints. After establishing a 12-1 lead at the start of the game, the Perth team never looked back. Coach Cal Bruton ran the entire bench.
Of course, Cal Bruton now, Dennis, would be looking to sub fairly freely. As long as he can maintain the tempo, he's got a cushion out there that he can try to play a few different players into form, and he can try some different things out there.
Stupinder, Crawford and Grace plays, proving hard for the Spectres to beat. Like his teammates, Tiny Pinder had no trouble working with Grace when he joined the Wildcats at the start of the season.
When Cal was playing with us, me, him and Jason, we had this combination going, and after he left, so Ricky came in, and so Ricky fit right in perfect, because now once we get our fast break going and you know, the game is flowing, then You know, Ricky can create a lot of things for me and James, and which is good. So we haven't lost anything because Cal recruited the right guy and he came in and did and was doing the job that he, you know, he brought him to do.
The game is lost, so he's going to enjoy himself. He'll be up.
He has nothing to lose right now.
Grace, that was lovely.
27 points up at three-quarter time. The margin blew out to 34 by the final buzzer. The Wildcats winning 123-89.
Sure, the West Side Melbourne Saints just want out of here. It's 123-89 as the Wildcats have a big, big win. Everyone got plenty of court time tonight. The Wildcats increased their record then to 11-6.
The next week, the third-placed East Side Melbourne Spectres came to town. Although the visitors controlled most of the game, they shot only 56% from the foul line. Thanks to a big third quarter from James Crawford, the Wildcats pruned a 12-point half-time deficit back to 7.
Wildcats come away through Grace. Crawford on the right, inside Perry, off the glass with the layup. Spectres in man-to-man now. Lockhart matched up on close. Bolden on Crawford. Doesn't stop Crawford making the two. 82 plays 68. It's a big worry for the Wildcats. That's the first time tonight James Crawford has got Bolden off his feet. Crawford baseline. Checked himself around Lucas. Banking off the glass for two more. Crawford's doing a manful job for the Wildcats as he has in the last three matches. Really their main man when it comes to points. There's a rebound, great effort.
Then in the final term, the home team caught up twice. But with 1.8 seconds left in the game and his team 3 points in front, James Crawford fouled Kent Lockhart.
I remember the ball being thrown up in the air. It was like a lob pass. I saw it, so I'm looking and trying to. I was just focused on the basketball. I had front position, so I grabbed the basketball, but also Lockhart really launched himself into the ball, and it was like a clash in the air, and they gave him advantage, so it was a foul.
Made the first, and remember, Lockhart was the guy that transgressed with the travel earlier when the Spectres had a chance. There's pressure here. He's went for it off the ring. That's the ball game.
By the skin of their teeth, the Wildcats made it by just 2 points.
What a sensational finish. It's actually 118 to 116.
Looking down the barrel of a three-week NBL break due to the Goodwill Games and the World Championships, the Wildcats faced the Tigers minus Andrew Gaze the next week on their home court. The Tigers had lost to Adelaide the previous night on the first leg of the Doomsday Double. Although the Wildcats established a good 10-point lead in the first quarter, the rest of the game was played on basically even terms. Tiny Pinder was the MVP with 30 points on the night.
Makes two and the bonus.
If the opportunity comes, I take advantage of it. Before, I used to just dunk everything, you know. I leave it up to James now. He used to do all the dunking. I'll just do all the jumping, because I jump a lot. If I do a lot of rebounding and I do a lot of dunking, then my legs get sore, you know.
Ellis. The Wildcats recorded their sixth straight win, 122-107. In doing so, they took fourth spot from the Melbourne Tigers on the NBL ladder, a situation which surely would have pleased part owner Kerry Stokes. Stokes is the head of an investment empire which spans three continents. He also has a sports good manufacturing and distribution operation in Asia, oil and real estate interests in the USA, and an entertainment empire in Australia. Stokes is the man who sold Perth's new Channel 10 3 months before it opened because the conglomeration of Australia's TV networks had left him a minor player. But his ownership of the Perth Entertainment Centre has made him a major player in the Wildcats' future. He now shares the reins with building baron Bob Williams.
I'd been cajoling Bob, in fact, for the last 3 years to allow me to have an interest in the Wildcats. And at one stage, we considered it earlier, and it didn't work out. It certainly wasn't a mere financial transaction. Bob obviously could have gone through the Basketball Federation to a whole host of other people who would have been interested. I think that we had something in common in that we shared Bob's vision for what he wanted for the Wildcats, and we still do.
Bob Williams is the chairman of construction giant Interstruct, the man whose vision brought the Wildcats from rags to riches in the NBL. He sees the build-up to an NBL title needing the same teamwork as a major construction project, and he's happy to have Kerry Stokes on the team.
Well, I'm personally very delighted that Kerry's involved. I think he fits in very well. His ownership of the Perth Entertainment Centre brings enormous opportunities forward for the following years. his own personal interest in the game, his stature in the community, the type of person he is, I think he fits in extremely well.
I think we got on very well. I mean, one of the nice things about Bob, whom I've known for a long time, he's not an egotistical person. I hope I'm not an egotistical person. I regard our role there to support what he has started. When he was a visionary for the game. He formed the Wildcats. He made them happen. Hopefully what we're going to do with our involvement with him is support that and help him to achieve what we think are the right goals.
The fact these two powerful businessmen have become close allies in the Wildcats' cause speaks volumes for the respect they have for the players. Williams says businessmen can learn valuable lessons from leading sportsmen.
There are enormous parallels between what we're setting out to achieve with the basketball organisation and business. The synergy between the two is quite remarkable, and that's something that I've instilled and discussed with our people here over time. Principles of teamwork, goal setting, achievement, encouragement, all these things that run through both organisations.
One of Kerry Stokes' great loves is his art collection, but he describes himself as anything but a sophisticate.
Simple. I have very simple philosophies. I like to enjoy my life. I enjoy the things that everybody else enjoys, obviously. I enjoy the water in Perth. I enjoy fine weather, nice food now and then. I take a great deal of pride in the Wildcats. The thing that makes me feel really good about them is watching all the children around Perth, watching the explosion of children's basketball, and watching these children take great delight from the Wildcats.
I'd describe him as a good bloke and a good citizen, and I think probably that's the way that I'd like to be described myself, that we get on very well together, and he has similar interests, wants to cultivate the sport, wants to cultivate youth, is concerned about community issues, and we share a lot in that area.
Anxiety is probably another area where they share a lot, especially coming into the next game against the top of the table North Melbourne Giants. But on this occasion, they had nothing to worry about. Wildcats were alert, fast and aggressive and continually changed their zone defence. The game was close for most of the first half, but in the closing stages of the second term, the Wildcats took control, extending a 4-point lead to 16. And in a great individual performance, David Close shot 6 3-pointers for the game. Captain Mike Ellis thought it was finally payback time for North Melbourne.
You know, we owe them considerably over the last couple of years, especially the semi-final last year when they destroyed us. And I think everyone was really pumped to win that game, and we were at a stage where we needed to win as well, just to keep our standings in the six going. And unfortunately, what we did is we put all our efforts into that game and then sort of forgot about the one after.
The Wildcats have had their best victory of the season, without question. Cal Brooks would be delighted. Cursory handshake from the boys there. 107 to 96, or 117 rather to 96. Just tack on an extra 10. We can do that. The margins are great. 21 points.
The one they forgot about was Canberra the next night. It was Cal Bruton's 150th game as an NBL coach, but this one belonged to a good friend.
I heard McEachin played his 300th, and he put on a whale of a show, and I couldn't feel that bad because it was his day, and his mom was there, and all the things that I would like to have happened for myself, that was happening for him, so you kind of like to share in someone else's joy for a change, but...
The Wildcats were 9 points down at halftime. During the second half, they made a slow but consistent revival and led briefly towards the end of the closing term.
And lays it in for two, and the Wildcats are in front at 108 to 107, and they took the lead with 4 minutes and 5 seconds to play in the ball game.
Despite James Crawford's 41-point contribution, they simply couldn't maintain the lead and went down by one solitary point, 114 to 113.
A foul that comes from Mike Elf, and the time is gone off the clock. There is absolutely no time left on the clock. That's the end of the ball game. They don't have to shoot the ball, and the Cannons have won yet another close one over the Perth Wildcats. They've been into overtime the last two times these teams have met, and this time they've gone also close to doing it. There's the final score. The Canberra Cannons 114, the Perth Wildcats 113.
The next week saw the Wildcats continue to struggle on the road. The Apollo Stadium in Adelaide, the 36ers had nothing to play for except pride. The first half was a close-fought affair, which saw the Wildcats in front by 2 points at quarter time and 1 point at the end of the second quarter. Tom Schaefer was shifted onto James Crawford at the start of the third, a move which paid instant dividends for the 36ers, allowing them to score 38 points for the term. But the Wildcats stayed in touch during the quarter, going 9 from 10 at the foul line. Despite the Perth team's 13-point deficit at three-quarter time, the last quarter was fairly even. The Wildcats couldn't make up the margin, and Adelaide took the game 112-99.
The ball, Pinder putting up the last shot. He makes it on the siren. A three-pointer, so it's 112-99. A very good win by the Adelaide 36ers. The Wildcats, very good losers here tonight. They've played it to the very end, but just not good enough on this occasion. We'll take a short break.
The Wildcats again swapped places with the Melbourne Tigers and dropped to fifth place on the NBL ladder.
We can definitely win the championship. You know, people have been saying it the whole year that the Wildcats have the best talent, but we have to put that onto the court as a team. You know, as individuals, we might have the most talent, but, you know, we've really been working hard. We've stuck together through all of this. And if you look at it, no team has really had a smooth road to the finals. Everyone has had their bumps and bruises, and it's just who performs and who clicks at the right time. And I think we have a great chance to be that team.
Fraud, a hoax, a con so big, so dawning, that it's enough to make you weep. I'm talking about a sport, the so-called growth sport of the 80s, going in the 90s, the big one. I'm talking about basketball. That's right, so-called basketball. They call themselves the Giants, the North Melbourne Giants. You've heard the name, Giants. I'm saying to you now, you've heard it, you're sitting there at home listening, Giants. Well, here it is, the truth. The so-called Giants are, in fact, I'm going to say it right now, a troop of performing midgets. That's right, they're not giants at all, they're a pack of little midgets. If you don't believe me, have a look at these statistics that Pamela Graham managed to ferret out. Davy Graham, 4'2". Scotty Fisher, 3'7". And get this one, Wayne Carroll, the so-called gunner, Wayne Carroll, 2'8.5". It's enough to make you sick.
Greg Hubbard.
On the first leg of their final two-game road trip for the season, the Wildcats travelled to the Wollongong Snake Pit to meet the Illawarra Hawks. It was a seesaw battle for most of the night, although halfway through the third quarter, the Hawks had a 13-point lead. But three successive three-point baskets from the Wildcats put the game back on an even keel. And by three-quarter time, the Wildcats were up by one.
As does Rick Watterson. Three-point shot from Eric Watterson, grabs the lead for the Wildcats at three-quarter time.
After scoring 26 points and 15 rebounds, James Crawford was fouled out halfway through the final quarter when the Wildcats had a tenuous one-point advantage. In a decisive tactical move, coach Cal Bruton switched from man-to-man defence to a 1-3-1 zone. From then on, Illawarra managed just two more points.
And a tip from Tiny Pender was a great move. The Perth Wildcats have certainly cemented their place in the top six, but this weekend anyway.
The next night it was on to Newcastle, and although the Falcons opened in good form, the Wildcats were able to gain a one-point lead by half-time. With Crawford and Bullock matching each other in the third quarter, Perth held a slender three-point advantage at three-quarter time.
Crawford now, trying to work James Bullock, does so, balls away, gets two.
With the scores tied at 119 apiece, James Bullock threw up a prayer shot with the clock showing zero time remaining. But because of the noise in the stadium, no one heard the final buzzer. Bullock was awarded two free throws after a controversial foul by Ricky Grace.
You know, we lost against the Cellar Dwellers in a very controversial game. They were a team that were hungry for victory, and we showed that if we show up against teams like that and underestimate, we're going to get beat.
The Wildcats were on their home pine for their remaining two regular season games, and the Gold Coast Cougars, while low on the ladder, were capable of causing an end of season upset. In the change rooms before the game, Cal Bruton was leaving nothing to chance.
Fellas, after we lost to Newcastle, we made up our mind that was going to be the turning point, all right? Now we're back home, we can gain the momentum going now when other teams are starting to falter a little bit. okay? This is the one that can set us right on the right path to where we want to go.
Having lost three of their previous four games, another loss could see the Wildcats tumble out of the top six. Grace made six three-point baskets from seven attempts. Fellow guard David Close hit with another four long-range shots, and that effectively answered the Cougars' disciplined zone defense, which for most of the night kept James Crawford and Tiny Pender relatively quiet, although JC did rack up his 3,000th point on the night as the Perth team scraped through to record their seventh consecutive win at home.
A little safer. They really have to get it away quickly. He tried to draw the foul as well. He tried to draw the foul from Ricky Grace to Ron Radler. That is very, very good thinking if it works. 98-94, the Wildcats have run out winners.
As the regular season drew to a close, the Wildcats were still not guaranteed a berth in the playoffs. They had to beat the Brisbane Bullets in the final qualifying game to ensure their campaign would continue.
I think the Entertainment Centre will be rocking tonight.
And in a show of skill and determination, the Wildcats took control from the opening tip-off, scoring 13 points in the first 3 minutes.
Nice move, James Crawford. Shot clock is down to five. Time running out for the Wildcats. Good defence from Brisbane this time around, but he breaks their heart.
It was a total team effort as the Wildcats made sure of their berth in the playoffs with a 23-point win, 119-96. They finished the season in fifth place on the NBL ladder and will play the Melbourne Tigers in Perth tomorrow night in the first game of a best-of-three elimination final. The other elimination series pits the Brisbane Bullets against the Sydney Kings, with the first game in Sydney also tomorrow night. So the Wildcats have the score on the board to make the playoffs. The rest, of course, is up to them. Their destiny, as they say themselves, is in their own hands. Along with you, we wish them luck. Here are the cats.